Okay, good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce the speaker we have today, Dr. Michael McCorkadale from Mobius Microsystems. He is one of our most distinguished alumni, and as such, he's winning a College of Engineering recent engineering graduate award, and that's why he's here today, among other activities. He's the CTO and founder of Mobius Microsystems, which you're going to hear a lot about today, as to painting a backdrop for the experiences as an entrepreneur, especially coming out of Michigan, but in general in the electronics or microelectronics industry. Mobius is an analog semiconductor device company. It's taken many paths, as you see from the title of the talk. And it was found, is originally based, and it's still based on his research as a PhD student here under Dr. Richard Brown, who's now dean at Utah. He has won a number of awards other than the one that we're giving him now, but from the state and others about Mobius's work as just an important startup venture for the state of Michigan and in the general industry. So I'm not going to go into further detail because I know he has a lot of information he wants to convey to us. So Dr. McCorkadale.
Okay. Thanks, Dennis. Thank you. Okay, well, again, Dennis, thank you very much for this gracious introduction. It's great to be back. I'm glad we have a full crowd. I also know that one of our friends and colleagues is defending in 30 minutes, so you won't offend me when you step out, just so you know. It's okay with me. I can send you the slides later. But you're going to miss the best part, by the way, just so you know. So, you know, for those of you who know me, you know, this is, and as Dennis introduced, this is really the story I want to tell you about being here in Michigan and going to Silicon Valley, starting a company. Of course, we started here in Michigan. And actually, as opposed to other talks I've given on this topic, I've previously focused on things that are relevant to students and faculty and how do you start and incubate this thing. What I want to talk about this time is the 5 years I've spent in industry commercializing our work. And you'll see sort of how that's been this crooked path that I'm discussing here. And so a little more background on Mobius. As Dennis introduced, we're an analog semiconductor device company. We were founded in 2004. Our headquarters are in Silicon Valley. We do have a design center here in Ann Arbor. We're venture-backed with about $26 million raised to date. That's probably going to go up, as is the case in all semiconductor startups. Our core technology is a solid-state oscillator technology that is capable of replacing piezoelectric quartz crystals. And this technology was developed at Michigan. And actually, consistent with that, and just to help the audience sort of feel a little more connected to this story, a little bit of nostalgia for me, especially being back on campus. This was our testing of our chip here in January of 2004 up on the fourth floor. And of course, April, then I defend, right? Once the chip works, then you defend. That's how you... So this is why it's sequenced so well. This is a picture of Rich and I after my defense. You know, I've got a big smile because I'm moving on in life, as I'm sure a lot of you are hoping to do someday soon. In 2005, we moved to Detroit, and we had this incredible office overlooking downtown. It was right by Comerica Park. It had a great martini bar in the lobby, so this was a fun time. This was actually the space before we built it out, and then afterward here, the design center and the lab. And actually what happened, and again, this is not the thing I'm focusing on in this talk, but we had to raise money in California, inevitably, so we moved our headquarters to Silicon Valley. These are our offices here. If you start a chip business or work in a chip business, you either have to be in Sunnyvale or Milpitas. I think it's state law or something. I have no idea why this is the case. And maybe Fremont might be the other one, but Sunnyvale is the best one, I think. And actually, we moved the design center then in Detroit back to Ann Arbor last year, which is really nice because we have interns and other students coming from the university, and that really worked out a lot better for us. And we actually were able to build out bigger space. Today, we have these two offices. Actually, we have a worldwide rep network and sales offices. I don't even have it all captured here, but most of the sales cycle is obviously in Asia. That's where components end up. So today, I'm going to talk about this story of Mobius, and I am going to, since this is an electrical engineering department seminar, I am going to include a fair amount of technical content, and that's actually important because it's going to help you understand the technical challenges that had to be overcome to ultimately build the products that we do build. And then I'm going to focus on what those product embodiments were and how they've changed over the years. And what you'll find, this crooked path I'm talking about, you can sit in a vacuum and define a business plan and say you're going to make this product, and it's only until you engage the market that you actually have any idea whether or not that product's going to succeed. So then I'll analyze this story and conclude and leave time for some questions. So timing is a functionality that is everywhere in electronic components. And if you look at, say, this iPhone here, this is the 3G, it actually has five crystals on the main board here. And the functionality that supports ranges from the cellular radio to power management to driving the application processor and USB. And if you're not familiar with what a crystal oscillator looks like, this is a simple teardown of one. You have this quartz blank that is essentially sandwiched between a top and a bottom electrode, and then you have the active circuitry underneath to sustain the oscillation. It's actually an amazingly old technology. The Curies discovered piezoelectricity in the 1880s, and then by 1917, crystal resonance was being used for sonar, and in 1919, if you ever work in this interesting frequency control space, these guys are famous, Nicholson and Caddy, they were the first ones to build crystal oscillators, and they've been essentially the same ever since. And there are over 10 billion crystal units sold every single year. Quartz crystal growth is a very interesting process too. You start with these natural quartz fragments that are mined, you process these seed crystals, then you make a solvent, and I realize I'm going quickly, I'm just trying to illustrate this process. You prepare an autoclave, you seal it, then you have autoclave heating, and then the crystal grows, and the crystal takes 2 to 6 months to grow. Then you take it out, you take these blocks, you slice them into wafers, you polish them, then you photo etch them to make the individual crystal units, you stick them in a package, and then ultimately laser trim to the final frequency and ink the device so you have the final product. So I'm not expecting you to memorize that, but I'm just sort of illustrating, if you didn't know a lot about crystals, it's a pretty interesting process, and it's pretty involved. So is there a problem with that? The fact of the matter is the manufacturing process is very cost effective through economies of scale. When you make 10 billion units of something every year, you can make it pretty cheaply. In fact, you can sell crystals in Asia for as low as 5 cents, which is almost amazing to believe you could make margin on a product at that price. But the problem here is it's still 2 to 6 months for growing the crystals alone. On the scaling side, frequency and size have continued to scale historically, but these scaling limits are imminent, as I'm going to show. Functionality and performance, well, quartz is a very stable frequency reference. It's essentially a rock, and I'll show some data on that, but the thing here is that circuits are required to provide any additional functionality. It may vibrate at a very distinct frequency, but beyond that, it doesn't really do anything else. And lastly, although quartz has been scaling and is small, it's not integrated. It's not siliconized. It has not been created in a microelectronic form. And why is that? Well, like I said, quartz is a very stable reference. Intrinsically, it can achieve 100 ppm or 100 parts per million frequency accuracy, which is 0.01% over all operating conditions. It's also very high Q or high quality factor, which translates to low noise, and it's very low power. In contrast, silicon manufacturing can vary by 10% or more. You don't have native high Q devices, and you require more power to build oscillators out of silicon. So quartz, as I'm sort of setting up here, is really one of the last great holdouts for microelectronic integration. There are trends in this timing industry right now, and they are as follows. Frequency continues to increase. I'm sure you're familiar with the first revision of USB 1, then the second one, and there's a third one coming. But the quartz frequency references that provide those high bandwidth interfaces, the frequencies for those high bandwidth interfaces, are petering out. You can't buy quartz crystals over about 40 or 50 megahertz. So they need to be multiplied by large factors. Similarly, the size is also petering out, and more products like SIM cards or credit cards with chips inside require very low profile timing, and this is what the market is demanding that quartz cannot offer. And again, quartz is a rock. There's no additional functionality. So these market trends are trends that need to be met without sacrificing performance or adding cost. And again, this is a $4.5 billion in dollars this time industry. And that's why it's so exciting, because it continues to grow and has these trajectories that need to be addressed with some kind of new technology. So here at Michigan, I actually spent 2 years working with Clark Nguyen, who's now at Berkeley, and Wan Tai Shu, who's now CTO at Desera. Desera has pioneered these MEMS micro-resonators. These are essentially silicon guitar strings. And the way you can see this here on the left is the resonator. It's packaged as shown here. This is a two-die stack to encapsulate the resonator and provide vacuum. And then that is stacked on top of a CMOS die and down-bonded to provide the output frequencies. SiTime is another company in the Valley based on Bosch Research that has done something very simple, similar. They also have a two-die stack, and then their resonator is actually sealed in this single bulk micromachine process. So this work is very impressive. It's also very well funded. I think both of these companies are about $40 or $50 million in, and they have products on the market. The architecture is something like this, where you have this MEMS resonator, just to sort of describe those devices there. And then in CMOS, you have all of the circuitry that's required to support that resonator. Sustaining circuit, fractional end, phase lock loop, a temperature sensor, which does the compensation of the device, and the logic that ultimately dithers the PLL divide frequency. And the point here is, when I was working on all of this, I started thinking, well, if we're going to do all of this in silicon, the only thing we're putting off there is the resonator. Why don't we see what the limits are of what we could do when we do everything in silicon? And so we aim to develop a solid state or an all silicon frequency source. And this is something we started doing just at the right time. Radio frequency CMOS or RF CMOS was emerging. And now these nice high Q components were becoming available, so you could start to build good, accurate oscillators. And what we aim to do is actually in the 60s, several researchers at Berkeley and other places had worked for years on what are the performance limits of solid state oscillators. And in the 60s, they essentially abandoned it. So because you couldn't achieve the requisite performance, we started thinking, well, let's look at it again now that process technology has changed, now that we have these additional options, and let's see what the new limit is. So we conceive an architecture to achieve low frequency error, that's critical in frequency control, and low phase noise and jitter. And we were also developing with an eye toward wireline applications. So the reason I emphasize this is these applications have sort of looser tolerances. They still use crystals, but USB, for example, only requires 500 ppm accuracy in its frequency source. So although quartz can provide well below 100 or 50 ppm, you don't need that. So if we could start to serve these applications, then we could start to replace quartz. Of course, if we could get below 100 ppm, that would be a great achievement. So a little more on the technology side. I'll dive in here and then we'll come out. What we do in our product is we free run a high frequency multi-gigahertz LC oscillator. Then we design in precision analog process trimming, open loop temperature compensation. We buffer the power supply from the oscillator, frequency divide by a large ratio to push the noise down. And then ultimately what we do is develop a 10 to sort of 200 megahertz frequency output, which covers the bandwidth of all the typical reference frequencies and well beyond, as I described, because quartz does not scale this high. Simplified architecture looks like this. Here you have a transconductor with an LC tank, bias circuitry, and then these thin film capacitors that are switched in and out to trim the center frequency. And then we have these varactors that are tied back to a temperature-dependent voltage. That enables the oscillator to be temperature compensated because it has an intrinsic temperature coefficient that must be corrected. The chip-level architecture looks like this. We take the LCO, we buffer it with a band gap reference low dropout regulator, or LDO, and then provide a programmable temperature-dependent voltage that enables the oscillator temperature coefficient to be corrected. And the rest is straightforward. Differential to single end conversion, programmable bank of dividers, configurable output drivers, and then logic that gets wrapped around it. An I2C interface, spread spectrum control, and of course NVM, non-volatile memory. Non-volatile memory stores all of these trimming coefficients. Now you might think this is something that once you execute on it and get the accuracy, it's very simple. And in fact, it's extremely complicated. Even the LC tank alone is not just LC. When you have a microelectronic or integrated LC tank, you have loss in the coil and the capacitor RL and RC here. And the thing is, you end up finding out very quickly that the resonant frequency is not root 1 over LC. You have to solve the zero phase of this network, and you find out that it's actually this expression. And what's worse is these loss mechanisms in the metal that comprises these components actually cause a temperature coefficient to be exhibited, because the metal is a real resistive material that has a TC on it. So the temperature drift, though, in the end, it can be estimated. It's negative, and it's concave down, dominated by the coil. So now you have to correct it. So once you implement this chip, I showed this very simple architecture. You implement it. How does it actually come together? Well, it also doesn't come together very well, or very easily, excuse me. The temperature compensation circuits are very sensitive to self-heating effects in packages with high thermal resistance, or theta JA. So what I'm trying to illustrate here is that this is an electrothermal simulation of our product. Here is the core oscillator. Here is the LDO, or the low dropout regulator, and here is the output driver. So as you would expect, those are the three hottest parts on the chip. But once we raise the voltage, which a customer would do on the LDO, there's a huge spike in the power dissipated on it, and what's even worse is the whole die temperature increases globally. So this mismatch between the compensating circuits and the temperature of the LCO can cause significant problems in ultimately compensating it. And of course, these are things you can't foresee out of the starting gate when you start to build products like this. A few other things, even the sustaining amplifier is a significant source of frequency error. There's this very interesting thing called harmonic work imbalance. So that transconductor, it keeps kicking the oscillator to keep it oscillating because it has finite loss. And what happens is that creates an imbalance in the work between the capacitor and the inductor, and that causes frequency error. So to illustrate this, this blue line is the current going into the capacitor. And what's happening is on every cycle, the transconductor is injecting current. It all goes onto the capacitor because that current can't change in the coil instantaneously. This is basic circuits 101. But what that ultimately ends up doing to the voltage waveform is distorting it. And that distortion causes a frequency error. Again, not something you would easily foresee, but you can solve a closed-form solution for this, and it's based on the Fourier coefficients of that sustaining current. So there, this is just to sort of provide some sort of technical background on this, all these different effects to build a silicon or a solid-state oscillator. There are a myriad of other higher-order effects. For example, if we sort of bin the whole net oscillator frequency error, we have the inductor, its loss, eddy current effects, parasitics. The capacitor has the same kinds of effects. The transconductor, I talked about this harmonic work imbalance. And then this is something you also don't learn until you start to build products, environmental effects, stress from the package, permittivity, or other effects of the package on the fields that are coming out of the die. So for example, what you're looking at here is a cross-section of our product. So this is the top metal, which is in a conformal process, conformal last metal process. And then you see the epoxy molding compound here. And the reason this is a problem is now this epoxy molding compound is presenting a new permittivity to the fields that are on the chip and therefore shifting the frequency. But what's even worse is that epoxy molding compound is now between the windings of the coil and it imparts a stress separating those windings. So both can be contained. We actually have a proprietary process that we've developed to contain it. I learned about an interesting one from Mina today about a process she developed at Georgia Tech which addresses the same issue. But this is something that you can't necessarily foresee until you see how these environmental effects affect the device. So, production challenges. Each device, each design is a major challenge. Models are typically missing these parameters. These higher order effects are often not simulated. Yet what we've been able to show is the presented architecture can be trimmed ideally, any single device can be, but then you all of a sudden have to trim it economically. And again, remember, we have to trim each device because the frequency varies from device to device, the temperature coefficient varies from device to device. So I just want to show some pictures here. You know, phases of production development are interesting. I mean, we've been developing test algorithms and test hardware to make our devices testable in 1 second, which is a huge effort because when we were first doing this, it used to take an hour to find the optimal trimming state for our device. And I think there's almost as much technology in the chip as there is in production test. And we developed a phased approach here where you have this multi-site test platform, you have multiple insertions here, and then we ultimately moved that to an actual production load board that was operator driven, and then the program is running on a PC, and now this is our production test load board that's going into the test chamber head. So the point here is this isn't at all like research. At research, you need one device to work long enough to graduate and get the hell out of here. This is like making, we're making millions of units of these things. So I was very impressed by how difficult it was to get all this to work. And the main driver is cost. Can you get the part tested and trimmed in the lowest? And I see Joe back there, so I know he's very familiar with all of this. So we've been at this for 10 years, 5 years of research, 5 years in industry. And how do we stack up? Well, this is the latest product embodiment we're going to introduce in a few weeks. It's in a 130 nanometer technology node. And you know, during all that time, guess what happened? These assholes in Texas showed up and copied our technology. So I'm going to come back to this and why it's interesting. And by the way, I learned alumni can swear in seminars. I just listened to. I was in the business school, and Sam Zell dropped about 4 F-bombs in his talk. So I was really impressed. So these guys, whatever, they're copying us. That's fine. I'll come back to why that matters. But what's interesting now is, let's look at how we stack up in terms of technology, and then I'll talk about product embodiments. And I'll just go through this quickly. We can take one of these standard crystal oscillators, look at the two MEMS devices, the Sarasai time, and then the two silicon oscillator devices, our device and Silicon Labs. And there are a lot of different dimensions to measuring these products, but the fact of the matter is these are the most important ones. How accurate is it? How low noise is it? And actually the other side of noise is how low is the jitter? And so when you look at a crystal oscillator, what I'm showing here is the normalized frequency error in ppm. So that's the frequency error in parts per million on the y-axis against temperature. So you can see crystal oscillators are extremely accurate against temperature. DeSera's device is very impressive, actually. It's competitive with quartz on the accuracy side. Psi time, a little bit less so. But here's what's fascinating. The Scilabs device and our device, now I realize they're not as good as these, but they're below 100 ppm. So when we started this, everyone thought we were crazy. Nobody could build a silicon oscillator better than 1% accurate. That's 10,000 ppm. Now we're building sub 100 ppm. It's, in my opinion, an unbelievable achievement that only two of us now have done. And that's not bad to be in the competition with Scilabs. They're the most respected analog company in the world right now. On the noise side, you're looking at phase noise here. So this is just the noise that's not at your fundamental frequency. So you want it to go to zero as soon as you move away. So this is the offset frequency. And so the quartz oscillator looks like this. DeSera looks like this. This is pretty interesting if you're familiar with MEMS. This close to carrier phase noise here is very high, despite the fact that the MEMS oscillator is high Q. So this high Q benefit of MEMS actually is not realized in the product. And then far from carrier, you just see the phase noise tracking the output VCO. SciTime's device has a very similar performance. Silicon Labs and our device, also very similar performance. And again, the interesting thing, our device is not a high Q resonator. It's an RFLC resonator with a Q of about 15. And the close to carrier phase noise is as good as MEMS. And the far from carrier is actually far superior to MEMS. But don't forget, quartz is better than all of this stuff. So that's still the case. But the main takeaway here is the technology is good enough to serve a lot of applications that quartz serves right now. This is jitter. So what you're looking at are a collection of periods and then their distribution. So the tighter the distribution, the lower the jitter. And you can see these four different devices here. And actually, our device and the crystal oscillator have the best jitter. Silicon Labs is pretty close. And actually, the MEMS device has very high jitter. And that's because of this far from carrier phase noise problem. So technology summary, that's what I was saying earlier. None of the emerging frequency generators really rival quartz on all dimensions. But the CMOS implementations, our product implementation and Scilabs, they have the lowest jitter despite having a significant difference in quality factor. Also, the potential for integration because they're in standard CMOS. They're a single die frequency generator and offer the highest functionality. And as I was saying, CMOS oscillators now achieve performance that no one would have ever dreamed of 10 years ago. In fact, when I left working on MEMS and started doing this, I think people were literally laughing at me that this was a fruitless endeavor. So the fact that we got here and Scilabs got here with almost the same performance is really amazing. But the MEMS implementations, as I showed, they're still ahead on the accuracy side. So their performance is a little bit better, but they're about 3 or 4 years ahead of us in development. So that's where we are. That's all the technology that went into it. If you think I put all of that in my dissertation, then you're crazy. I wrote as little as I needed to do to go and do this other stuff. So obviously, a lot of that had to do with industry. And this is where I'm going to take a step back and start showing how we did this. We started with these simple prototypes I did as part of my dissertation work. This is actually a micrograph of one of them. The performance was good, but not great. We did demonstrate very low jitter and phase noise, and also compared that to how MEMS devices worked. And then we looked at temperature coefficient. Now here, again, you can see the air on the y-axis and the temperature on the x-axis. You're not looking at 10, 20, 50 ppm. You're looking at hundreds, thousands of ppm now. But the interesting thing was that 2,500 ppm, for example, is the low-speed USB requirement. So that means that we were just on the cusp of serving one of the crystal applications. So we sort of thought naively, oh, well, we just have to tweak a few things and we can serve that, and then tweak a few more things and we can serve that. You know, I'll tell you that's not the case, but this was the thinking at the time. Then we embedded the IP into a microcontroller. This is actually part of the work that was going on here. So that's the clock IP macro, and this is it under test. The WIM Center here has a project that's been going on for years now to build these 16-bit microcontrollers, and this clock IP is embedded in the first two generations of it. And this was a nice demonstration vehicle. We replaced the crystal and we showed our little clock macro is only about 3% of the total die area. You could do a cost analysis, you could test the chip. Everything was great with this. So we founded the company in 2004, and you can see the technology, performance, and status were as follows. We had great jitter and phase noise. Frequency error was on the cusp of being able to serve some applications. This wasn't the ultimate performance, but it was good enough to start. We had already built the technology as an IP and a microcontroller. We had samples in hand from my dissertation work, and then we had IP with the Office of Tech Transfer. So the launch originally was to build an IP business, an intellectual property business. So what that means is we do the design for a portion of the chip that would be able to replace the off-chip crystal oscillator. And the reason we did that is the value proposition was the strongest there. I mean, it's an integration value proposition. The capital requirements were also very low. An IP business is kind of like a software business almost. In the end, your deliverable is a file that someone else sticks into their chip. So we executed a license agreement. We raised $2 million of local money. The company consisted of me and several colleagues from university, and this was actually the most exciting time of my entire life. I never had so much fun ever. And we went out to market and found these great applications. So this is a USB to 232 bridging cable. You've probably seen these before. And if you open up this blue part, what you find inside here is a controller that requires a crystal for timing the USB interface. So this is this product, this is actually the product before Mobius was embedded into the chip, and this is the product now after Mobius is embedded. And if we take a look here, actually I can show you the micrograph. So this is our customer's chip, and then this is our custom IP macro that's sitting up here in the corner. So to my knowledge, to our knowledge, this was the first commercial replacement of quartz ever. We designed this, it's a 0.18 millimeter squared and a 0.35 micron CMOS process. This thing is still shipping in volume, it's done over 10 million units to date. We've published it in Journal of Solid State Circuits, so where this was around 2005, 2006. So this was a big success. The problem was, it is a terrible business. So, the NRE, the non-recurring engineering, is so high for every customer because every customer is at a different foundry making their chip, different technology node, different process options, and you realize every single time you have to re-spin the entire design, which is not easy to do. You can see it's not a simple design. So the IP revenue was also loaded on the back end via royalty. That's the main thing. Nobody wanted to pay NRE up front, which you would have to incur to do the design. But then they would pay it on the back end, which makes you wholly dependent on whether or not their product actually ships in volume. So the revenue stream was always exposed. The business didn't scale. It started to look like a services company. And actually, in the end, no one would give us any more money. So, you know, it was great job. This is a great product, great technology. This is terrible business. Go get money from someone else. So we wrote a plan to build components now, not IP, build our own components based on our technology. Now the capital requirements go way up. You can't raise that money in this town or this state or this region, actually, which is something I've lectured on before. So I went out to California. We raised $10 million in that round. moved the headquarters to Silicon Valley, and started to build a so-called professional team, but really hired some complete jackasses, actually. The new management team, and you'll see how bad it is, they constantly argued with me, discredited me and the team that we had in Detroit. They were the experts, we were the idiots coming from graduate school. This is just the way the world works, that's fine. Then they defined a product that was a 25x fold increase in where we were in performance. So this is like saying, okay, look, we could put the monkey, you know, in outer space, but let's just go straight to Mars. I mean, why do we want to waste any of our time doing these other silly things? So that was their thinking. 2 years of development go by. There are many issues that are masked in the product because the product embodiment got so complicated trying to meet these aggressive specs that it was almost impossible to debug. If you've ever made an analog chip, it's hard enough to debug with 10 transistors. Now add an extra 10,000 that you didn't even need. So it's a huge issue. And there were, of course, other unforeseen technical issues, like this packaging issue that I described. This was something we didn't really see till we were doing long-term environmental testing on the device. And that required real technical solutions. So these simple production challenges weren't addressed. And the icing on the cake was the management team goes to the board while I'm on my honeymoon and tries to fire me, literally. So this was, I didn't even read the title. This was the worst time of my entire life. So if you want to know who not to work with in Silicon Valley, I can tell you. But we got the product done, finally. So this is our quarter micron implementation. This is our wafer leaving the foundry in Taiwan. This is the product here. So this was our first component after all that fighting, after all that trying to fire each other and whatnot. So we announced that product in 2008 at ISSCC, as well as the Global Press Electronics Summit in 2008. And so what did that product really do? Well, you know, we sort of thought of it like this. I mean, we were very proud. Okay, this is the first single chip component as a frequency source, and look at this big honking ugly thing that we're getting rid of. The reality of it was really more like this. This is the state of the art. This is the MEMS device. This is the state of the art crystal device. This is our device. Can you tell any difference? Because there isn't any. It's all the same. And so this was also a bad business. It's replacement by definition. We're just see if I go back here and look at this crystal. If you populate that crystal or you populate us, what is the difference? There's no difference in the product. So it's replacement, and so by definition, we don't enable anything. And quartz is still better than those other technologies. That's why I spent all that time showing all the data. Quartz is still the best performing technology. So we may be good enough for a lot of applications, MEMS may be good enough for a lot of applications, but quartz is still the best. And no one was really very interested in the product, but we did have some dimensions that interest people. The high frequency, the available high frequencies, the low costs, a few other things. But we realized if we built this business, it was going to be a slugfest. We were pushing the product and getting no market pull. But the main thing that happened here is we had samples. We had samples so we could engage the market. And that's where I learned, this is one of the most critical things, is you can't learn anything about your customer if you don't have anything. Everyone, seems very obvious, right? Not to most people. You can put data sheets out till you're blue in the face. Until you have a product someone can hold in their hand, they're not gonna do anything with you. So the solutions, well, of course, we rebuilt the whole management team. We got a great CEO. Actually, the team is great now. We raised $16 million on a wing and a prayer and some bullshit story, I don't even know. We were just hand waving, you know how that is. But now with the team, we started focusing on differentiation. How do we use the technology to build differentiated products? And meanwhile, the technology continued to scale, right? I showed where we were in university and now where we are commercially. So this was exciting. We go out into the market, and we've run into this application. This is a little mini card reader. So you know these SD micro cards, they go into the side of it and then you plug this into your PC to get the pictures and things off. It's a simple product when you look at it. You have this little controller IC here and some passives. And on the other side, you have the connector and the crystal. And so what was interesting is a public company in Taiwan, Realtek, who's the leader in making these controllers, claimed to implement RIP and therefore these controllers no longer needed the crystal. So all of their competitors called us terrified that they were going to get washed out of the market because there's really no differentiation in these controller ICs. Now, we don't want to do the IP business, right? I already explained this is a terrible business. We don't want to do a custom design for each one of those guys. So what we said is, how about this? What if we sell you the die? And this is what we're selling them now. So this is actually their package, and the package here is dissolved away so you can see what's inside of it. And this is our chip stacked on top of their chip. And this now really has, this is the best product embodiment we have made to date. It has the strongest value proposition, it has the greatest market pull, and actually, I'll tell you the way you know that you're doing something right, the customer is doing something new with the product. You can't do this with quartz, you can't do this with the other technologies, but they did this, they said, let's jam it in the package. You can do that with a sliver of silicon. That's a way to know that you're succeeding. So the advantages of this product embodiment, it's actually just like IP, but it's not. It's still a component business. We sell die or wafers to customers, and it allows our technology to be implemented optimally on its own process technology node with its own requirements and not be a slave to what the technology is of our customer. And there's actually a lot of reasons we can win in this business. We have the lowest cost structure, being a single piece of silicon at an older technology node. We have the only single die solution that you can stack in the package. We have a wafer level production flow. And this is the most beautiful thing. We don't sell against our competition. We make them obsolete, right? We sell to the chip guy. We don't sell to Apple and try to fight it out with, you know, don't buy MEMS, don't buy quartz, buy us. We sell it to the chip guy and then they sell it to Apple and Apple says, oh, I guess I don't need a crystal for this part anymore. I mean, it's actually genius, if you ask me. Not that it took a long time to figure this out, but anyway. And again, I want to emphasize, it's real because customers are using the product in a unique way that quartz can't be used. So I want to keep going here. So looking to the future, actually, so this was exciting, too. Once that happened, this was almost like the serendipity of we had RF CMOS available, so now we could make great solid-state oscillators. The interesting thing that was happening and the reason customers would stack our die is because SoC, or system on a chip, is fragmenting. It's fragmenting due to cost. As you keep going down in scaling the technology node, the analog doesn't scale and gets more and more and more expensive. So it makes no sense to keep designing single chips. It's better to actually separate them and stack them. And we're seeing customers do things like this, stack 6, 7, 8 chips all on their specialized technology node because this is the lowest cost solution. And this is a very simple way to do it. This is how our customers are doing it. Just stack them together and wire bond them down. But what makes this even more real, our new technologies for stacking are now becoming mainstream. TSV, or through silicon via, this is a product by STMicro which confirms this hypothesis that I'm talking about. Here, they've already separated analog and digital. You can, I don't know if you can see, the digital is in a 45 nanometer technology, and the analog is in 130 nanometer, and now there's a through silicon via, so you don't need the wire bonds, you just stack them together. So this is a major trend that is emerging in industry, and here's the beautiful thing about it. Our timing die is a wedge into this. We already have customers saying, okay, we're buying your timing die, we want to export more of this analog off our SoC. So you guys are analog experts. Can you put more analog on your die? Because you're already in the right technology node. You already have the timing. Build all of that in, and we can get rid of it on our SoC. So just to recap a few events, you know, and then I'll sort of leave it to a discussion, and hopefully we can have a few questions. You know, the performance of the core technology when it came out of university was sort of on the cusp of serving markets. That's why it was valid. That's why we could raise money to do it. But it has scaled to unprecedented levels, as I illustrated, in the past 5 years. We launched the company with an IP business, had low capital requirements. We targeted lower performance apps. It was a great success, but a terrible business. Then we built a component business, launched on a very high capital raise. Management team was a disaster. Product took forever to build. It was a terrible product and a terrible business, but the thing that happened in that cycle was engaging the market and figuring out what customers actually wanted. And of course, meanwhile, Scilabs enters the market. Then the die business emerges. Another company supposedly copies our technology, but our management team understands that. We understand differentiation, and then we productize into the die to compete with that issue that's in those particular applications. And even more importantly, the product performance now has scaled to these unprecedented levels and really much better than we ever thought would be the case. And that component business now is becoming viable. So we have business there actually selling components. They're usually differentiated on sort of one or two factors, like your product is lower power than the crystal oscillator or higher frequency. But there is traction there now, just not as much pull as with the die business. And then ultimately with that, we now see this larger industry trend in a separation of SoC. Now the analog and digital planes are being separated, and we can be a leader in providing the products that will be on this analog plane, because our wedge into that already is our timing product, is a unique product in that space. Okay, so just, I know this is running out of time here, but just a few comments. So, you know, understanding the ingredients here, I think the starting point when you look at what we've been doing, you have to develop a unique and defensible technology. You have to get the best people, not people who will fire you when you go on your honeymoon. Focus on differentiation. That is really the lesson here. You know, how does your enabling technology allow you to build a differentiated product? And you will know what's happening when you see your customer doing something unique with that product. You need to accept that the performance of the technology will scale and sequence the product development effort accordingly. I talked about this, you know, monkey in outer space versus the mission to Mars. You have to have that right sequencing. The technology will scale over time. You have to define the products in tandem along that path. And accept that the first productization efforts will be very poor, but know that they allow you to engage the market. So I always say, get the first product done quickly, get the second product done correctly. That's the way to engage. And then identify, if you can, a coming wave in your industry and try to intersect with it. So this is what I was describing about this fragmentation of SoC and analog now being this separated die, this new wave, and we're already playing in it as an analog timing die. University research is half-baked, and I just want to emphasize this sequencing issue. It always seems closer to done than it is, but the reality of it is productization will inevitably uncover all these unforeseen technical issues, because you didn't just make one and write your dissertation. You now actually have to make millions, and that's a huge difference. The good news, though, is engineers and scientists are very smart. If you give them time, the performance of the core technology will always exceed your wildest dreams. If you look at our products and every product I ever look at that's come from university research, where it was and where it is, you could never foresee that it would improve that dramatically. But the most important point is to sequence the product definition in tandem with the current performance level. Don't overstep where you are in defining a product based on that technology. Technology push versus market pull. You know, this is something I wanted to emphasize as well. University technology transfer is always a push. You're trying to find a place to put it. You're not being pulled by customers. You don't have customers showing up here, oh, show me this great university technology that's half-baked that I want to sink all this money into and waste my life, right? So established industry, though, has that. They have the customer accounts. They have the market visibility. If you haven't been in industry, this is how it works. You're already in the accounts with your existing products, and the customer tells you, make that, make that. You don't even have to think. You just go back, you argue with your management team, define the product, and then you go make it. So the push is very different than the pull. And the push, why I'm emphasizing it, it's unique to commercialization. Other startup companies are usually identified with a pull. That is that there's someone in industry, they leave the company, they identify some pull that their company is not going to chase. And you found the company because you're going to go after it. Tech transfer is not that way. It's this push that I'm emphasizing. And you have to keep pushing, as this story illustrates, until you find the pull. That's the way to engage the market. So if you look at our experience, you know, I realize I'm really emphasizing this, but if you look at it, we had significant pull on IP, but a bad business. Original components had little pull, but enabled market engagement. All the while performance is scaling, component is revised per market feedback, and then this threat of IP and one of these other guys in USB came and resurfaced where we were able to actually capture it as a die product. And that pull led us into the greater trend of analog die stacking. So this process of finding that pull is a search, and that search actually really requires a lot of patience and persistence. We've been doing this now 5 years since we transferred out of the university, and you can see all these iterations in the product and the business. You know, I've met very few people who know how to do this, and I think it's critical that people understand product development, sequencing, and these things, that performance scales. You have to have an execution plan and engage the market. Understand this push-pull effect. Understand this is what I said actually at Illinois. Understand that this process, it's kind of like a slow-motion car crash. You know when you're about to hit and everything slows down and you feel the imminent disaster? You feel that every day in a startup company. At least I do. So just accept it, get over it. It's just, I don't know how else to, I just deal with it, so. Other entrepreneurial endeavors, in my opinion, are not the same as commercializing research because of this difference in the push. But I'll tell you, many VCs don't have patience with this commercialization process. We're fortunate that we have VCs who are, but I'm not gonna say they're thrilled about what's been going on to date, but at least they understand it. The problem is it's always capital intensive when you commercialize research. It always takes a long time. The technology will inevitably not work or have some shortcomings. And many of these investors don't understand all of these things that I'm trying to communicate to you about the process. So you must find the right people to work with. Competition, just real quickly on this. You know, I mentioned it, and the funny thing about it, so SciLab's SI500, this is their all silicon product that's similar to ours, I guess. You know, it actually did more good than bad for us. It validated the silicon oscillator technology. So actually I had one of my friends at one of the MEMS companies here called me and he said, congratulations, a public company copied your technology. They didn't copy this MEMS shit. So I felt very flattered. Now, I'm not saying anything against, I'm just saying it was an interesting compliment. It also exposed their productization and marketing plans. We saw where they were trying to go with the same type of technology, and I'm showing you how we're going through these gyrations of figuring it out. Now we see them visibly where they're going. The other thing is, in a component business, you always need a second source. If we sell a chip to Apple, Apple's first question is, who is the second source for that same product? So every time they get a design win, we see it, because we can be a second source. And interestingly, SciLabs competes with many other companies in the frequency control space. So they have this technology and this product, all these other companies don't. So we became an interesting acquisition target because of this activity with SciLabs' product. Same with Realtek. They supposedly incorporated RIP into their controller, but it didn't work. But it terrified everybody because they thought, look, we're not gonna have differentiation. Realtek's gonna take the whole market from us because they have integrated timing. So they came and sought IP from us and we gave them die. In the end, it all worked out well. And so one thing I want to say about this is the only way to validate you have a good idea is if someone else is working on it. If you're the only one doing it, trust me, it's a terrible idea. And the other thing is, business events are neither good nor bad. They're simply opportunities. What makes them good or bad is how you react to them. So I'm not going to say we had foresight in how these things would pan out, but you know, the knee-jerk reaction is, oh, you should go sue those guys and force your patents against them and all these other things. But we didn't do any of that, and then look how it actually panned out for us. So that's the thing I want to emphasize. So just some parting thoughts, and then we'll leave it open for questions. You know, this process of commercializing research, I think you can see, is extremely challenging. You need this sound, defensible technology. You have significant capital requirements, patient investors. You need excellent people who understand how this is done. That would be probably my number one advice to anyone trying to do this. It's a process of sequencing development and searching for this pull, and it's riddled with challenges and failures. We didn't just pack up when we said, oh, this IP business is terrible. We tried to make the component, and then the component wasn't so great. We didn't pack up then. We have to keep going in order to succeed. So what can seem to be kind of a random process, what I was hoping to do here is take a pass at framing it and understanding it and explaining it to you so it can actually be sort of executed more orderly and hopefully more successfully than we've been able to do to date. But the fact of the matter is I don't know if it can be optimized. It really just helps people when they understand what's happening. You don't want to be caught off guard with a disaster. You want to know the disaster is imminent. That makes people feel comfortable. So this is this process. And there's always external randomness that can help or hurt your business. We have competitors implementing our technology. The thing to do is to react so that it helps you. Don't freak out or flip out that the sky is falling. But in the end, for me, from my experience, there's really no bigger challenge or better satisfaction than making a new product based on new technology. There's a lot of different businesses, there's services businesses and all that. I always tell people, real men and women make products. If you make, there's nothing else harder you can do in life, making a product. So if you really want to rise to a great challenge and have all the satisfaction, go try to do this. I've never been more satisfied and I've never been more defeated in my life, but it's been a hell of a ride. So thanks for your attention, and I'll take questions.